Hello, I'm Peter King, and welcome to the MMQB podcast with Peter King, where I take you inside the minds of the biggest influencers in the NFL. This week, All-Pro quarterback Drew Brees of the New Orleans Saints and Pro Bowl wide receiver Doug Baldwin from the Seattle Seahawks. An excellent show. I asked Brees, would he consider letting his kids play tackle football at a young age?
I don't think tackle football is necessary until you get to middle school or high school. I think that there's just not enough coaches to coach proper technique with pads on with kids in elementary school.
Also this week, I asked Doug Baldwin about the future of the movement begun by Colin Kaepernick, where players do not stand at attention for the national anthem.
You know, there's an issue that needs to be resolved, and it should start on the training level. You know, and not necessarily saying that police officers are not trained well, it's just that the training needs to adapt to the times and to our society now.
Those conversations and my thoughts on the state of the NFL. Now my conversation with the 11-year quarterback of the New Orleans Saints, Drew Brees. Back on the Peter King podcast, here with Drew Brees. Drew, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie It's a Wonderful Life, but the reason why I'm prompted to use this today is because I wonder what would have happened to this city if you never came here. And if in February of 2006, coming off shoulder surgery, the Miami Dolphins had signed you, which, I mean, that's what I thought was going to happen. You were going to go play for Nick Saban. Could have changed the course of history, not just you, but imagine if Nick Saban stays in Miami and doesn't go after 2 years to Alabama. What happens to college football? What happens here in New Orleans? And I wonder if any time you ever think about what could have happened had you traveled differently and gone to Miami instead of come here.
Well, there was definitely some divine intervention there that led me here to New Orleans. It was, you know, looking back just on that process. I mean, listen, I never thought I'd leave San Diego. You know, when I was drafted by the Chargers in 2001, I think my mindset was that this is where I was going to be. This is where I was going to stay. I was going to be the quarterback of this team, lead this franchise for a long time. I mean, I think every young quarterback has those aspirations whenever they're drafted somewhere, is that, you know, this is the spot. And, you know, unfortunately, in that fifth year, I had the shoulder injury, and, you know, they had drafted Phillip, and, you know, it was just one of those where I knew they were looking for any reason, you know, to be able to put the young guy in there who they had a lot invested in, obviously, and knew he was going to be a great player, as he is. But, you know, the choices were Miami and New Orleans. And I think just on the surface, you would have said, oh, it's Miami by a long shot, right? Like you said, Nick Saban, who arguably there was a lot of excitement around him as the head coach there in Miami. He had kind of turned the team around that year in 05, and so there are high expectations for 06. I had played against him in college, you know, so I knew the type of coach he was, type of defensive mind he was. There's a lot of great coaches on that staff too: Jason Garrett, Mike Mularkey, Hudson Houck, a few other guys that I knew and knew very well. It was going to be the same system. I mean, all these things seemed like they were lining up to be Miami, and yet there was just this feeling that you know, we belonged in New Orleans, and it was well beyond just football. You know, it was about the rebirth of this city and being a part of that. And just how many people in their life get that opportunity. Just really felt like it was a calling.
If you go back to that time, do you believe that you made that decision as much for football reasons as personal reasons? Or what was the biggest reason now with a decade of perspective why you made the decision?
Well, I loved Sean Payton, you know, and he was a guy who was, you know, unproven as a head coach. I mean, it was his first head coaching opportunity, but, you know, was a Bill Parcells disciple. So I think coming from Marty Schottenheimer, I knew what to expect there.
Yeah.
You know, hard-nosed football coach, hard but fair, but just this great offensive mind. And what struck me immediately when I got here to New Orleans, just in speaking with him during kind of the recruiting trip, so to speak, was that he said, listen, here's my offense, but here's all the things. I mean, he pulled up all the San Diego tape. Here's all the things that I see you doing very, very well, things that you're confident with, things that you love. This is going to be our offense. the things that you do well. We're going to, you know, basically build this thing around you. And that took me back, because typically, especially a first year head coach, I think you step in and you feel like it's got to be your way and we're making changes and follow me. And yet I felt like we were in it together from the very beginning. And so I felt like that was very unique. So I love Sean and I loved his approach. So yes, football, but man, there was, I think just the personal side of it, the looking around and just feeling like this really was a community. This was a tight-knit community and we could be a part of this community and really make a difference in this community. That was a huge factor.
You're one of the few athletes who, when given an opportunity, and I remember when Sports Illustrated named you Sportsman of the Year, I remember when we were talking about it around the office, you know, one of my points was that this is a guy who, long after the sort of crisis of Katrina ended, this is a guy who still was doing things years later, you know, 3-4 years later. So do you believe that that part of being here has been maybe not as rewarding as the football part, winning a Super Bowl and is playing as well as you have, but what about the long-term reclamation project that this city has been?
Well, I think it's all worked together, you know, honestly, but certainly what we've been able to give and what we've been able to be a part of in regards to the rebirth of this city, and not just tangible things like, you know, structure, and but I think lifting the spirit and creating that bond. I mean, I think that's something that will truly live forever and something that I think all of us carry with us in everything that we do now. I mean, there's a vibe to this city that it's hard to explain unless you've spent some time here. And I think a lot of people have recognized that when they come here, even if they're not a resident and they're just coming for a short period of time. I think they feel something very unique. There is a spirit to this city that is unlike any other. And I think a lot of that was fostered through those first few years of recovery post-Katrina and all the people that were a part of that.
Do you still find yourself doing things to try to help parts of this community that were unalterably damaged by Katrina?
Yeah, we're always looking for ways to give back to this community and to help this community. I think it's been an evolution. You know, I mean, there's things that we were very focused on, you know, in the early stages. In the early stages for us, it was how do we make families feel comfortable coming back to New Orleans, that they have schools for their kids to go to and parks and playgrounds and athletic fields, and, you know, so their kids can have a normal childhood, you know, and have all the opportunities to be successful in life that, you know, that you hope and dream for your kids. And that part's never changed. I mean, we continue to try to find ways to do that for people and for this community. But I think we've seen New Orleans evolve into like this, it's like this small business mecca too, and it's this entrepreneurial hotbed. I mean, we've got all this young entrepreneurial talent coming to New Orleans to try to start businesses. It's really a land of opportunity. It was created after Katrina. And so we're doing a lot with entrepreneurship programs to help, you know, try to recruit this talent to the city to help create businesses, which helps create jobs, which helps drive the economy beyond just tourism, and helps the community grow into a place where, hey, people want to live here, people want to raise their kids here.
So, Drew, let's talk about football a little bit. You're 37 years old. A couple of years ago, you said, I want to play till I'm 45. And I don't know who's going to play longer, you or Brady, but I have a feeling that one day they're going to put me in the ground, and the last thing I'll look up at the TV and I'll see you're 58 years old, and you and Brady will be dueling in a Super Bowl. But so what drives you still to play this game and to play it at the high level you're playing?
Well, if I'm playing it, then I'm going to try to, and I'm going to be the best that I can be at it. I'm never going to be in a position where I'm just going through the motions. I'm here to win a championship. You know, that's my job. And I think for me, yes, we won one, and that was in my ninth year in this league. And here I am in my 16th season. To win another one would be so meaningful, because I feel like it would be literally with two totally different teams. You know, I mean, there's very few guys left from that original team. And as I look at a guy like Peyton Manning, you know, he won one in his ninth year and then his 18th year, right? And literally two different teams, one's with the Colts, one with the Broncos, but, you know, you'd say two different stages in his career as well. Mm-hmm. Brady won one in year 2, 4, and 5. You know, there was that, you could say that dynasty in New England. And then, listen, they've had a ton of success since then, but he didn't see another one until year 15, you know, 10 years later. It's interesting how...
It's interesting you know those years, those numbers. You study those.
Yes. So it would be extremely meaningful to win another championship, and that's what I'm here to do. I also love playing this game. I love being around my teammates. For a long time here, you know, just talking about the skill position guys, you know, it was Marcus Colston, it was Devery Henderson, Robert Meacham, Lance Moore. I mean, we had that run together 6-7 years where it's hard to maintain that type of consistency with that many guys for that period of time. And now I see this new crop that's here, and I feel like we can do the same thing. Brandon Cooks, Willie Snead, Brandon Coleman, Michael Thomas. And so that gets me excited, really excited to come to work every day to work with these guys. You know, my own children, my kids, I got 3 boys, age 7, almost 6, and 4. And, man, you talk about, like, diehard football right now. I get home yesterday after a long day, and they just want me to throw to them. And one catches it while the other hits him, and does he get in the end zone or not, you know? And it's – so they are so into it right now. And for them to be a part of this, like, the memories that we're creating for them is, you know, you want that to last forever.
Your son, Baylen, now is 7. He's playing flag football, right?
Yeah.
How does he like it?
He loves it. He loves it. He's playing receiver. And the cool thing is one of my best friends and I were the coaches for the team, his flag football team, this in the spring. And in order to make it fun, we named all the position players after Marvel superheroes. So going from left to right, it was Iron Man was the receiver. Hawkeye was the center. Captain America was the quarterback. Hulk was the running back. Flash Man was the slot. And then Thor was the flanker on the right side. So my son playing Iron Man, he was the X. You know? He was Brandon Cooks. So,
but was, I hear Baylen is a bit of an Odell Beckham fan.
He is. He is. So all 3 of our boys here in New Orleans go to Newman, which is where the Mannings went. It's also where Odell Beckham Jr. went. And so it was in 2015 before we played the Giants that Giants were coming to New Orleans to play. And Newman made a big deal about, you know, 2 Newman alums coming back home, Eli Manning and Odell Beckham Jr. And so for some reason at that moment it clicked with my son. This was right before Halloween. So he's like, I want an Odell Beckham jersey. I want to be Odell Beckham for Halloween. I'm like, whoa, listen, we play these guys on Sunday, all right? I'm not going to have my oldest son running around in the opposing team's jersey. You know, I said, let's just wait till after this weekend, and then you can be a fan of whoever you want.
Does he still have the Odell jersey?
Yeah. Well, what's funny is typically what they'll do is when we have games in the backyard, 2 of them will dress up in Saints jerseys. And then they'll typically put the youngest, Callan, who's 4, into the opposing team's jersey so that they can just knock the crap out of him. So they'll put him in we got a Giants jersey, a Lions jersey, and maybe
you
one
know,
other.
There seems to be, speaking of that, there seems to be a movement toward flag football with the really young kids in the United States now. We just did a story at the MMQB, this town in South Carolina. Now, if you are below 8th grade, mm-hmm. youth football is flag football there. So how do you feel about that? Because I think you didn't play tackle football until you were in high school. Is that right?
Yes, that's right. I played flag football 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, and then I didn't play tackle football until 9th grade.
What do you think about the whole education process?
I think it's a phenomenal idea to play flag football up until middle school and potentially high school. I mean, I think at some point it's the decision for the parents, you know, and the child as to whether you play tackle. But I don't think tackle football is necessary until you get to middle school or high school. I think that the game is so much more fun, and you learn so much more about just the fundamentals of, you know, throwing, catching, running, you know, concepts, defense, and that kind of thing through flag football. I think that there's just not enough coaches to coach proper technique with pads on with kids in elementary school. You know, that's just the truth. And I think kids have more fun playing flag football, because in flag football, everybody has a chance to, you know, run the ball, catch the ball, throw. That's not the case in tackle football. You're either a lineman or you're a skill guy. You know what I'm saying? We're